Alright, it is now recording. Then share the screen, desktop. Okay. So, good morning once more time. Depending on the value of damping ratio, the system becomes undamped, underdamped, critically damped, and overdamped. You know, you remember that beautiful figure, where were they? Here it is. So undamped, there is no decay at all in the oscillations. It keeps oscillating. Underdamped, after some overshoot and undershoot, it settles down, underdamped. This is critically damped, zeta, where zeta is. Well, I can write here. Underdamped means, undamped means zeta is zero, undamped, so there is no damping. Underdamped is where zeta is between zero and one, under one, underdamped. Critically damped, zeta is exactly one, and overdamped is where zeta is greater than one. Okay, this yellow response was obtained from first order. Okay, very good. Now let us study this underdamped case a little bit more detailed. Why is that? Because underdamped systems are the most frequently encountered ones, and they are also the most general one. You can describe undamped and overdamped responses depending on the underdamped descriptions. We will see. Now, suppose that we are studying underdamped systems, all right, systems. What does that mean? The zeta is something between zero and one, and it is the same thing. The roots are complex conjugate, right? Okay, so the suppose that we have this input 1 over s, and the system is omega n square over s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. So this is input, this is the system, all right, and this is the output. Okay, now the output is going to be C of S is going to be omega n square RS times G of S. S times S square plus 2 zeta omega n S plus omega n square. How can we let us obtain the time responses? I can write the time responses directly taken from here, but let me show it to you with a couple of lines. Let us obtain this, because by means of these expressions we will end up with very useful statements. Okay, how can we do partial fraction expansion for this transfer function? We know that S, there is one pole at the origin, a real one, so it is just k1 over s, plus we know that this part is complex conjugate because we already specified the system as underdamped, so the residues will be k2s plus k3 over s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Okay, now let us multiply each side of this equation by the whole denominator. Okay, so the left hand side will become only. The left hand side becomes only omega n square. Okay, but the right hand side will become k1 times s will disappear, only s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Plus for this term, if you multiply by the whole denominator, this part will disappear, just s times or k2 s plus k3 times s. Okay, so let us arrange this right hand side so that we can see as a polynomial in the polynomial form. So the coefficients of s square is will be k1 plus k2 s square. All right, how about s 2 zeta omega n k1 2 zeta omega, what sort of a zeta is that? 2 zeta omega n k1 plus, there's another s term, k3 s. What has left as constant term? Only k1 omega n square. K1 omega n square. All right, so, well, it seems one equation, three unknowns, k1, k2, k3, but not because it is in polynomial form. In order to, you know, obtain this equality, this equation, we have to equate all the terms, you know, correspondingly. What does that mean? Omega n square. What is the constant term here? This term. So k1 has to be 1. All right? K1 has to be 1. And this term must be 0. So k2 must be minus k1, minus 1. Okay? How about k3? K3 is going to be minus 2 zeta omega k1. K1 was 1. So it is minus 2, okay, minus 2 zeta omega n. So we have, we know as all three residues. Now, the equation, the partial fraction expansion is done. The equation is going to be like this. C of s equals k1 over s, 1 over s. K2, k3, they are both negative, so take the negative sign out, okay. K2s, just s, plus k3 plus 2 zeta omega n, 2 zeta omega n, over s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Now, we are experienced. We are experienced with Laplace transforms. We know that we are dealing with complex conjugate, and the time domain expression will be something, will have some trigonometric terms, sine and cosine, but you will see that they will be damped cosine and sine. So we can immediately remember, you know, that that knowledge, and we can write like this: s, okay, s plus something square, zeta omega n, s plus zeta omega n square. Okay, I'm writing this this bit. Okay, so s plus zeta omega n, s plus zeta omega n square. Okay. Plus, there is omega n square, okay? There is omega n square. But from here, there will be s square plus 2 zeta omega n s exists. Plus zeta square omega, and we have to get rid of this zeta square, okay? Oops, oops, oops. zeta square, omega n square. We have to, you know, keep the denominator unchanged. So the term, and we want to make this square of something. So we can write this as omega n times square root 1 minus zeta square. I don't know if you can follow me. I'm just converting, you know, just manipulating the denominator so that we can use this Laplace transform table, as you know, s over s square plus omega square was just cos omega, right? But omega over s square plus omega square was sine omega, all right, omega t. All right, and the shift theorem, if there is a s plus a square plus omega square, okay, s plus a, that means exponential minus a t cos omega t, right? And you should remember this. So here, I want to see what 1 over s minus, I want to see s plus zeta omega n here. Okay. S plus zeta omega n square, no problem with it. And omega n square root 1 minus zeta square. Okay. So s plus zeta omega n. We had two zeta omega, and that means add another zeta omega has to be written here. Now I want to see square root of this constant term, which is omega n square root 1 minus zeta square. Omega n already exists, so multiply this by 1 minus zeta square and divide it by the same quantity. Okay, 1 minus zeta square. I think we are done. Okay, now we can take the inverse Laplace transform and get this. What is the inverse Laplace transform of C of S? C of T. And 1 over s, just 1, minus exponential, what, zeta, exponential minus 80, minus zeta omega n t. Then, cos omega n 1 minus zeta square t, right, plus what? I need this term, plus zeta over square root 1 minus zeta square sine omega n 1 minus zeta square t. That's it. So this is this term, okay? 1 minus zeta omega exponential minus zeta omega n cos this and sine. Okay. I may convert these two trigonometric term to only one trigonometric term. Now you remember this. Do this simple triangle transformation. Okay. So C of t, okay, equals 1 minus exponential zeta omega n t. No problem. So far, the coefficient is 1. So do this 1 square plus zeta square over 1 minus zeta square in this parenthesis. Okay. If you do this, in fact, from here, you get what you get is 1 minus zeta square plus zeta square. 1 over square root 1 minus zeta square. So that means you are taking out this from the coefficient of cos. So just reciprocal of this. So okay. So write this 1 minus theta square, okay, cos plus plus zeta, okay. I'll check it out. Sine something, okay. Are we doing okay? If you multiply this 1 over square root something times this, they are just reciprocal. So 1 is obtained. If you multiply this, yes, we are doing okay. So why I did all these things to do this? Phi, let us take here 1, the cos, coefficient of cos 1, and and here 1 minus zeta square, 1 cos phi will be 1 minus, and this is what, if this is zeta, if this is zeta, what happens? 1 plus zeta square. Help. 1 over, I did this, yes, zeta. If I write here zeta over, but the hypotenuse will be 1 plus zeta square, but here 1 minus zeta square. How do we do that? Oops. We are doing something wrong somewhere. 1. Maybe I should have given you the directly the resultant equation. Excuse me. We are 1. Yes, 1 square plus zeta square divided by 1 minus square. If you do this, 1 over, yes, this is correct. So if you C of t equals 1 minus 1 over 1 minus 1 over 1 minus theta square, right? Exponential minus theta omega n t. What happens to the inside of this parenthesis? So 1 minus theta square cos omega n 1 minus zeta square t, okay, plus zeta. There is only this term, huh? Zeta, what, where are we? Just zeta, okay, zeta sine omega n 1 minus, okay, t. We are correct here, I think. If you multiply this, just you get 1 and zeta over 1 minus zeta over 1 minus zeta square. Mm-hmm. So I one square plus theta square over one minus theta square. Okay, so one divided by one theta square. And from here. Okay, so if we carry it to here, one oh yes I saw why am I okay, I'll delete here. Okay. Now, this part will be one minus zeta square. So we need to obtain this, and here, what was cos phi? Cos phi was the this side. Okay, one. I'll correct it now. This part is one, okay. This part is one minus zeta square, okay. And this part is zeta. How about now? I think the hypotenuse is one, right? One equals one minus zeta square. Plus zeta square, right? Good. Now, C of t equals one minus, okay, one minus one over one minus zeta square exponential minus zeta omega n t, right? So instead of this square root one minus zeta square, we can write sine phi, okay, not sine phi, come on, cosine phi. Okay, cos phi times cos omega n blah blah, plus instead of zeta, we can just write sine, okay, sine phi, sine something, okay, and the resultant equation will be one minus one over one minus zeta square exponential minus zeta omega n t cos omega n one minus zeta square t minus the phi angle, and phi is so easy, it is just arctangent arctangent zeta, okay, over square root one minus zeta square. You can find some or from arc cos, arc sine, whatever. Okay, now we have these either in this form or in this form. We have the time function, very well described time function for second order underdamped system. Why is this so important? You will see now. First of all, as you see, if you normalize this, if you just select omega n a constant value and change zeta from 0.1 to 0.8, you will get these outputs. What do you see here? As the damping ratio value changes from almost zero to almost one, okay, you get some oscillatory signals, because we know that underdamped second order systems for under them second order systems, we know that zeta is somewhere between 0 and 1. If it is 0, it is just oscillation, okay, forever. If it is 1, there is no oscillation. If it is between 0 and 1, if it is near the value of 1, there is less oscillation. If it is near 0, more oscillation. So the lower the value of zeta, the more oscillatory the response is. Okay. Now, can we describe, suppose that we have a typical, okay, we have a typical, this is step input, and suppose that we have this typical output, right? How can we qualitatively describe this output? We can measure, we can define some parameters like rise time, like peak time, or in some books, it is called time to peak, okay, peak time. And okay, there is some overshoot, undershoot, but we know that the first overshoot is maximum. There are some. Hocam kusura bakmayın, yeni gördüm. Yes. You should have shouted. Okay. Anyway, we have calculated these relations by assuming that the coefficients are all zero. No, we did not in the equation and found k coefficients, but the other option is to plug in the poles in the equation to get the equation. We will discuss this, okay? We will discuss this. Rise time, peak time, percent overshoot. Okay, it does some overshoot, but how much? For example, suppose that this is 1.2, the maximum value. If this is C of T, C max is 1.2. If I ask you how much, you know, what's the percentage, what's the maximum overshoot, you can say that, oh, it makes 20% overshoot. And I would say, oh, that's too much, because 20%, I expect some, you know, suppose yeah, this is temperature control, I expect 10 degrees, it gets first 12 degrees and then 10 degrees, so that will be too much. And please find some remedies to reduce this overshoot. Or rise time, how quick it rises, or percent overshoot, as just we just described, and settling time, how long it takes to settle, you know, down to a level. So these are the things. This is the output C of T. Okay. This is C max. Okay. This is C final. This is called C final. In other words, C steady state. Okay. What else? The rise time again from the 10% of the final value. The time required to go the response from 10% of the maximum of the final value to 90%. Okay, this is the rise time. Peak time, where the first peak occurs, the time required for the response to reach at its maximum. And this is the settling time. We defined it before. Okay, how can we evaluate the peak time? We know that the output is omega n square divided by s times s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square, right? How can we find peak time? We know it even from high school. We can just take the derivative if you take the derivative, and because when you take its derivative and make it equal to zero, derivative is finding the slopes. If you in maximum and minimum values, in extremum values, we know that the slope is zero. So how can you, you can use the time function to take derivative, which takes time. Instead, because Laplace transform provides us easy, integration and differentiation operations. So let us, how can you take derivative of this? Just multiply by S times C of S, we get omega n square over S square plus 2 zeta omega n S plus omega n square. Okay. Now, this is the, if you take its, inverse Laplace transform, that means you are obtaining the derivative of, or C dot derivative of time function. So derivative of time function is going to be, in fact, omega n square divided by, now it is easy, S plus zeta omega n square plus omega n 1 minus zeta square. Okay, I need to see, the square root of the inside of this square here. There is already omega n. So delete this one omega n. And write here omega n 1 minus zeta square. Okay, and divide it by 1 minus zeta square. Okay. So you get C dot of t will be this, okay, omega n, okay, over square root 1 minus zeta square. It is just a damped exponential minus zeta omega n t. It is, there is no s here, so it is just a sine, right, omega n 1 minus zeta square t. So this is the derivative. And if you make it, equal to zero, you will find the extremum points, okay? How, if you look at this equation, this equation could be zero only because of this sine function. And the argument of sine function, if this is n pi, right? I think the sine zero, sine pi, sine two pi makes zero. So n pi, this argument omega n square root one minus zeta square t equals n times pi, right? So that this equation becomes zero. For n equals zero, you get the first peak, first extremum, this value, okay? For n equals zero, we get the value of, this, okay? And for n equals one, we get this following, point, which is the required one, okay? So for n1, t becomes peak time, okay? So from here, peak time is going to be n is 1, pi over omega n 1 minus zeta square. Look at this nice result. Why nice? Why nice? If I know the damping ratio and natural frequency, I don't have to do all those, Laplace transform, inverse Laplace transform, etc. Just you know, pi is 3 point something, 3.14 something, pi over omega n. I know omega n, I know damping ratio, I can immediately know time to peak. So nice. Another parameter, percent overshoot. Okay, so very nice finding. Percent overshoot. How do we describe? This book uses this percent overshoot. In many books, it is MP, maximum peak. But we don't use this because MP is used for another parameter, resonant peak. We are going to use it for resonant peak. Anyway, percent overshoot is Cmax, I mean, how much, you know, how big, how much overshoot, the first overshoot, the measure of, you know, how much it does overshoot with respect to the final value, okay? Times, of course, 100, because we are doing percent overshoot. How can we find Cmax? Now we can use these time expressions we obtained. It took a lot of time. If you Cmax is C, in fact, T, P. So you either use this term or this term. I think you will see that using this term will be more convenient. So 1 minus exponential zeta omega n for T, we are going to use pi over omega n 1 minus zeta square, right? And cos omega n, right? Cos omega n 1 minus zeta square for T, TP, pi over, oops, omega n 1 minus zeta square plus zeta over 1 minus zeta square sine, okay, the same argument, okay? I'm not going to write it. Look at here, because I have already seen that these are simplified. So we get only cos pi, and from here only the same argument, sine pi. We know that sine pi is zero. So from here we get zero. And from here cos pi is minus one, okay? So this minus will make this one, okay? And use this percent overshoot will be Cmax is this one plus this exponential term, minus one, so plus one, minus, C final is one. This one will be disappear because of this C final. And you get this exponential, I'll use 100 here, 100 times exponential minus zeta, and we will see that there is a simplification here, minus zeta pi divided by square root 1 minus zeta square, okay? And again, if you know the damping ratio, on damping ratio, if you know the damping ratio, you would immediately know how much percent overshoot it makes. So percent overshoot and zeta damping ratio, they are directly related to each other. In fact, they are inversely proportional, but inversely exponentially proportional. because there is an exponential term here. Suppose that sometimes you would know damping ratio, and from damping ratio you can get percent overshoot. Sometimes the problem asks you, this is the maximum allowable percent overshoot. So from here you have to find damping ratio. So from here, with some simple calculations, you get zeta as this. Okay. Minus logarithm natural percent overshoot. Okay. Percent overshoot over 100. That means if it is 20%, just 0.2 divided by pi square. Okay. Pi square plus square of this here numerator. So ln square. Ln square means ln square doesn't mean you take 2 times logarithm natural. Just find the square of this value. Okay. Percent overshoot over 100. That's it. Look at here. This is a very nice graphics showing the relationship between zeta and damping ratio. Look at here. As damping ratio increases from 0 to 1, okay, the percent overshoot gets lower and lower. When it is 1, there is no overshoot. When it is 0, full oscillation, okay, 100% oscillation. All right. Please bear with me for another 5 minutes so that I can complete the evaluation of settling time as well. Settling time is another very important measure, okay, because sometimes it is more important than the peak time. You would like to know how long it does take the response to settle down to a level. This is again 2% settling time. Okay, it doesn't have to be in some applications. If you are happy with 5% overshoot, 5% settling time, okay, you can work in that way. So this time function with only one trigonometric term can be obtained. Look at here, using this definition, the settling time is the time it takes for the amplitude of the decaying sinusoid of C of t to reach 0.02. Where was it? So it the time required from here to here, okay, to here, is called settling time, or TS. The response reaches at this level, but remains within this band of plus and minus 2% of the final or steady state value. Okay, so if you make this okay equal to 0.02, okay, as we did where, as we did here. Okay, instead of doing all this term to 0.02, we are doing a sort of conservative estimate, conservative approximation, and we are assuming that cos something here, cos the argument is 1. So actually it takes even less time to reach at this level. So if we are just making this part equal to 0.02, and we obtain this easily. And if you give value to zeta between 0 and 1, from 0.1 to 0.9, you see that this numerator changes from 3.91 to 4.7. So usually they take this. It's a kind of approximation, okay? So the settling time is approximately 4 over zeta omega, zeta omega n. If you remember, in first order systems, this is second order system. In first order system, as you may remember, it was 4 over a, or 4 times time constant. In fact, this is the reciprocal of time constant of second order systems. So this is the, if you know again, zeta and omega n, you would estimate the settling time. And if you remember, peak time was an exact equation, pi over omega n 1 minus zeta squared. So we know settling time, we know peak time, okay? And rise time. Rise time, you wouldn't obtain an analytical expression for rise time, because it is a bit complicated. Why? You should obtain some expression for 10% of the final value and 90% of final value, and take obtain time statements and take the subtract from each other. It takes time. So instead people are using this. By means of these time expressions, for different values or for various values of damping ratio, you get normalized rise time. I mean, omega n is just not changed, nor omega n t is changed. You get these graphics either from this table or from these graphics or plots. You get, you can obtain, if you know the omega n, if you know the damping ratio, okay, from here you can estimate rise time by means of this table or this plot. Or in some books, for example, this is another well-known book, Dorf and Bishop's book, by means of a kind of curve fitting method, you can linearize this nonlinear relationship between damping ratio and normalized rise time, and it becomes like y equals mx plus n, a linear equation, right? And from here you can get this very approximate equation, okay? 2.16 zeta plus 0.6 over omega n. Again, if you know zeta and omega n, you can immediately estimate the rise time. Okay, now before the break, suppose that this is the transfer function in hand. Okay, find peak time, settling time, percent overshoot, and rise time. And maximum value of the response and final value of the response. I can ask other questions as well. Look at here. First step is you need to find zeta and omega n. Okay. Use the denominator s square plus 15s plus 100. Okay. S square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus, oops, what I did. Oops. Excuse me. Okay. s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. So obviously omega n is square root of 110 radian per second. And damping ratio is 2 zeta omega n equals 15, right? So it is going to be 15 over 2 times omega n, which is what? 0.75. So tell me if this system undamped, underdamped, overdamped, or critically damped. It is obvious since zeta is between 0 and 1, okay, the system is underdamped. Underdamped. How much percent overshoot? What is the value of percent overshoot? So easy, percent overshoot is, we know the formula. You don't have to know by heart. It is 100 times, 100 times exponential minus zeta pi over 1 minus zeta square. Okay. Why don't we use MATLAB? Where is MATLAB? Here it is. Since I use these equations so frequently, you will see that it is there. So zeta is 0.75, okay, and percent overshoot, I think. Here is the expression, 100 times exponential minus zeta pi divided by square root 1 minus zeta square. Enter. Oh, very small percent overshoot, 2.84. Okay, 2.84. So 2.84% overshoot, almost nothing. Okay. And what now? Peak time is just pi over omega n. The omega n 0. Omega n is 0.75. No, not come on. Omega n was 10. Okay, 10 times 1 minus, okay. And you get peak time. Peak time should be here. So omega n was 10, okay. And time to peak is, look at here, omega, pi over omega n square root 1 minus zeta square. So this is 0.475 seconds, right? And settling time is almost not at 4 over zeta omega n. Zeta was 0.75 times omega n. Ts is 0.533 seconds. But that's rise time. Rise time, you can use either this formula or what was it? What was the value of zero, zeta? 0.75. Go to this That's here it is. It is between 0.75 is here, between 2.126 and 2.0 Let's take it, I don't know, 2.3. Okay, so normalized rise time, TR times omega n is 2.3, n was 10, so rise time is 0.23 seconds. Okay. Yes, the same value, 0.20. And if you use this curve fitting method, you get almost the same result. Okay. Now you can even by means of using MATLAB, you obtain the response, and MATLAB gives you the result on the plot. Settling time, it says 0.574. But peak time must be more accurate. Peak time is 0.475, not bad. And percent overshoot, 2.84, good. And rise time is 0.23, which is very, very good responses. Okay, I think we should stop here and take a break. Let us start. Yes, let us start at 11 and carry on, I don't know, until what time. Okay, I'll make a tea for myself. Stop share, stop recording, pause recording. Okay, it is recording. And share the screen. Okay. So this was the response. Now let us see the relationship between the pole location and the response. You already know this relationship, but let us make it clearer. So suppose that we have underdamped response, okay? Suppose that we have underdamped. Underdamped is just one word, actually. Underdamped response, where zeta is greater than zero but less than one. And the poles are where? Poles are at S12 minus zeta omega n plus and minus j omega n 1 minus zeta square. This part, this real part, is called the sigma d, okay, exponential damping frequency, and this imaginary part is called omega d, damped frequency of oscillation, damped frequency of oscillation. So the poles are minus sigma d plus and minus j omega d. Okay, if you locate these poles on pole zero as pole on the complex plane, complex S plane, sigma and j omega. So this part, the real part, is minus sigma d or minus zeta omega n, and the imaginary part is j omega n 1 minus zeta square. On the other hand, if you remember, peak time was just pi over omega n square root 1 minus zeta square. We see that the denominator of this statement, omega n square root 1 minus zeta square, omega n square root 1 minus square root, is just imaginary part. So we can say that peak time is pi over, okay, imaginary part of the pulse, or pi over omega d. On the other hand, settling time was 4 over zeta omega n, and zeta omega n is in fact the absolute value of the real part, right? So we can say that settling time is 4 over real times of pulse. The other, we can say that peak time and the imaginary part, they are inversely proportional. Also, settling time and real part of the poles are inversely proportional. What does that mean? If you take the real part of the poles to the left, if you make it large, if you make the absolute value large, you are shortening the settling time. You are making settling time small or short because it is time. Or if you are increasing the imaginary part, you are decreasing the peak time or time to peak. One more relationship. Suppose that this is the pole angle, okay? What is the cosine of theta is, I mean, I'm talking about absolute values. The neighboring side is what? Sigma d, okay, or zeta omega n, over hypotenuse is omega n, right? So, zeta is directly related to percent overshoot. And it is also directly related to this angle. So if you change this angle, you are changing zeta. In other words, you are changing the percent overshoot. Well, it is so obvious. If you go this way, you are getting close to the instable or unstable region. Damping ratio will get smaller, percent overshoot will get higher. You will see all these relationships. Look at here. I know this is not so clear, but I'll make it clear. Suppose that, okay, we have a second order system, and we are dealing with the poles of these second order systems. Okay. Suppose that the poles are complex conjugate. Okay. Complex conjugate. In the first case, the poles are here. Okay. This is case one. In the second case, we are increasing the real part. The real part was first here and then here. And then this is third case. Now, can you tell me settling time? What is happening to settling time? Settling time one, settling time for case two, settling time for case three. Are they getting shorter and shorter, longer and longer, or remains unchanged? What would you say? While I am enjoying my tea. All right. I'm waiting for the answers, and one answer came. I'm waiting more answers. Getting shorter. Any other comment? So it is getting shorter because the absolute value, the settling time is just 4 over real time of the poles, and the peak time is pi over the imaginary part of the poles. Okay, so since here we are getting we are making the real part large and large, so the short the settling time is getting short and short, so it'll be some yes am I doing okay? Yes, the settling time here is the largest one. So that these if since we are changing the locations of the pole along the horizontal lines, okay, since we are changing the locations of the poles along the horizontal lines,
sorry
dersim var ama isterseniz buyurun. Ben size geleyim hocam.
Bize sen de dersini yap. Adam sen dersini.
Ben dersini yapıp size geleyim hocam. Eski rektör yardımcımız. Efendim neyse. Dersimize bakalım biz. Where is the horizontal lines? Here it is. These... There. Let's go further, and then I'll. What happens to peak times? Peak time one, peak time two, peak time three. What happens to peak times? It'll remain unchanged. Yes, thank you. Why? Because the imaginary part remains the same. That's why these horizontal lines are called lines of constant peak time. Okay. Good. What happens to rise time, by the way? Rise time one, rise time two, rise time three. What happens to zeta one, zeta two, zeta three? What happens to percent overshoot one, percent overshoot two, percent overshoot three? Well, just let's say out of curiosity. Well, rise time, if you remember, rise time was getting shorter. They are the same. Yes, rise time. Like the settling time, it'll get short and short because rise time, as you remember, it was the where was that statement? Omega n. It is not easy to say something for rise time. I'll talk on this, okay, later on. But what happens to zeta? Zeta is this. Cos of this angle, cos of this angle, cos of this angle. We are getting close to the real axis or 0 degrees. That means it is getting large and large. So it is getting large and large. And percent overshoot will be getting small and small. Okay. And how about here? If we have this couple, okay, these poles, and in the second case here, and third case here. So we are moving along the, how do you say, sort of vertical line, not sort of exactly. Anyway, this is one, case one, okay, case two, and case three. We see that here, settling times are not changing, okay. Why? Because we are keeping the real part unchanged, but peak times, peak one, peak two, peak 3. The imaginary part getting large and large, so the system, the response becomes faster, or time becomes shorter, and something like this. Okay. And finally, if you move the poles along radial lines, okay. So, in case one, suppose that you are here. So, if you are increasing the real part and imaginary part in the same amount, I mean, the same ratio, 1, 2, 3. Both the settling times, 1, 2, 3, they are getting shorter. And peak times will be getting shorter, okay? But what since the angle doesn't change, the zeta remains the same, okay? So the percent overshoot is constant. Okay, percent overshoot 1 equals percent overshoot 2 equals percent overshoot 3. Okay, so these are called radial lines are called constant percent overshoot lines. Okay, those vertical lines are called lines of constant settling time, and the horizontal lines are called lines of constant peak time. Okay. And they are the, look at here. You are increasing the imaginary part. You are not the peak here, the peak time. Peak times are getting short and short, but small and small. Okay, look at here. The peak time for the first response is here. Peak time, okay, TP1. Whereas in the second step, peak time is shorter, and in the third step, much shorter. Okay, but envelope is the same. But why? Because if you remember, C of T was K1, okay, minus K4 exponential minus zeta omega nt cos omega n 1 minus zeta square t minus 5, okay? This minus zeta omega n is, in fact, the real part of the poles. And the real part, since the real part is not changing, envelope is not changing. So the responses decay, with the same speed, okay? Because the envelope is the same. So very nice, outcomes you can obtain. You can look at here, the same overshoot because the zeta is not changing. Whereas, as you see, the response becoming quicker, faster, since settling times are getting short, peak times are getting short, but the percent overshoot, how do you measure percent overshoot? The peak value, okay, remains the same. Okay, after a couple of examples, we are done with this important chapter. suppose that you have this pole zero diagram, or simply the poles are at minus 3 plus and minus j 7. Okay, these are, this is the locations of the poles. Given the pole plots, okay, find damping ratio, omega n, peak time, percent overshoot, and settling time. So simple, right? Omega n. We know, oh, the other, one more thing I should say. I should have shown you maybe here. It is already shown, but look at here. This is omega n. This hypotenuse. Okay, this is right angle, right? This is zeta omega n. This is omega. This is, if you say this part is just x, x square is square root of this part, this side, zeta square, omega n square, plus omega n square, okay, 1 minus omega n square. You see that x is, hypotenuse is just omega n square. These will be simplified, and square root of x square is omega n. Okay, so hypotenuse, well, if the poles are minus a plus and minus j b, the magnitude is omega, isn't it? So here, how can you know omega? How can you find omega? Omega is this hypotenuse. Square of 3 plus square of 7 in square root. So this is the omega. And zeta, you know that if you take the angle, this, okay, cos theta is zeta. From here you get this value. This is an obviously underdamped system. Underdamped, why? Because zeta is less than 1 and greater than 0. If zeta is great, not smaller than 0, that means the system is unstable. Okay, we are not working with unstable systems, obviously. Then this is percent overshoot, can be found easily. Peak time is just pi over imaginary part of the poles. Settling time is just 4, more or less, 4 over real part of the poles. Okay. Another example. Suppose that this rotational mechanical system is given. Okay, it's a kind of design problem. Given the system, find J, moment of inertia, and friction, viscous friction coefficient to yield 20% overshoot and a settling time of 2 seconds for a step input of torque. Obviously, you need to obtain the transfer function of this simple system. It's a 1 degree of freedom system. There is only one inertia. It's a kind of shaft. So if you remember, js square plus ds plus k, right? Sum of impedances times the displacement, okay, equals the torque. The torque applied, and the transfer function is g of s. Output to input. Output must be the displacement obtained, and the input is the torque introduced. Okay, so 1 over J S square plus D S plus K. Since we are dealing with this form, S square plus 2 zeta omega N S plus omega N square, the transfer function can be converted in this form. 1 over J S square plus D over J S plus K over J. Okay, now we know 5, okay? The K is 5, and we need to find J and D so that 20% overshoot. 20% overshoot corresponds to a particular value of damping ratio, right? Percent overshoot is 20, okay? Zeta is, well, zeta is this, minus logarithm natural percent overshoot over 100, which is 20 over 100, 0.2, divided by square root pi square plus square of this, okay? And from here you get 0.456, was it? 456, yes. Yes, here it is. And then what? We know K is 5. So K over J, and also settling time is given as 2 seconds, okay? 2 seconds, which is four of zeta omega n. From here, we can know omega n as omega n, okay? No need to waste time. But I think I followed a different way here. Anyway, omega n is, this is 2, omega n makes what? Two over zeta. Zeta was what? 0.456, which makes omega n equals 2 over zeta, 4.4 radian per second. Now I think we can know almost everything. Omega n square is k over j, 5 over j. Okay, from here j is 5 over omega n square. J is 5 over omega n square. 0.26. And d over j is, d over j is simply 2 zeta omega n. We know J, we know zeta, we know omega, and from here you can find D, okay? D equals 2 zeta omega and J. D equals 2 zeta omega and J. Okay, 1.04. Good. Okay. Oh yes, I should talk about what happens if we have an extra pole. I mean, how about when we are dealing with higher order systems. So far, we covered first order systems. No need to talk about zeros order systems. Zeros order systems are have no dynamics, right? There is no sort of time required for energy absorption. A simple potentiometer with low power is just a gain. If the input output relationship is just a gain constant, it is zeros order systems. First order systems we covered, spent some time on it, on them, first order systems, and second order systems. They are the most basic ones. And the after second order systems, what you call is higher order systems. Higher order systems, we don't have exact expressions for higher order systems, but we sort of establish some approximations and try to characterize those higher order systems or second or higher order systems with zeros. Here, suppose that we have an extra pole at minus alpha real, and these are the, I mean, suppose that we have this simple second order system, not simple. If, when you say simple, that means the poles are real. Suppose that this we have this standard second order system, and suppose that a third order is added, okay? S plus alpha, alpha real, just alpha. Depending on, well, comparing the real part of the second order poles, complex poles, their real parts and the location of the third or real pole, if how much they close to each other, this really affects the response. If look at here, case one, case two, case three. In case one, we are comparing the location of alpha r and the location of real part of the complex conjugate poles. If this real pole, the third pole, okay, this is the third pole. Why? Because two poles, two complex poles are coming from here. First and second poles are here, two poles coming from here, okay? If this third pole are far away, much greater than the real part of the complex conjugate poles, their effect on the, in fact, suppose that input is 1 over s, the unit step, the output will be some coefficient, okay, say k0 exponential minus alpha rt plus k1 minus k2, k3, make it k4, exponential minus theta omega n t cos something. Okay, look at here. This is our standard second order system. Okay, we studied, we analyzed this part. And here, is the something we added, okay? As I said, if the absolute value of alpha r large enough compared to the real parts, okay? As a rule of thumb, if it is at least 5 times larger than the real part of the complex conjugate poles, okay? The effect of alpha r on the time response can be neglected. Why? Because it'll die out quickly, you know, because it's exponential. It is reflected to the output, to the response as an exponential. If it is too large, that means it'll die out quickly. So there is almost no effect on the time response. As it gets close to the complex conjugate poles, it'll become more and more dominant, and the exact simulation have to be carried out. And systems with additional, I'll leave it here. We will come back to it later on. Systems with additional poles, as we talked about additional poles. How about zeros? Zeros do not affect the stability. They just affect the amplitude of the time response. Okay, time response. Look at here. Suppose that we have this pole, pole pairs, okay, minus one plus and minus j 2.83, and we added zero to minus three. Suppose that we have again this s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square, okay? But no need for parentheses, okay? And suppose that we added a zero to s plus 3 in the first case, and then to 5, and then to s plus 10, okay? This is case number 1, 2, 3. Look at here. When there is no zero, this is the output. And the closest response among those three cases is where zero is at minus 10. Why? Because the zero is so far away compared to the real part of the complex conjugate poles. Okay. Okay, you can have a look at this analysis. There is an interesting event, okay, you need to know this. Non-minimum phase effect. This is an interesting phenomena, okay, and it has to be dealt with really carefully. In fact, we are about to submit a research article to a journal dealing with minimizing the effect of this non-minimum phase effect on the pitch action of an aircraft, because it causes, look at here, if you have a transfer function of a system, okay, for example, s square 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. It could be some more poles as well, whatever. But if you have a zero, okay, suppose that you have poles, okay. But if you have a zero on the right, I mean, on the unstable region, this region is unstable, as you know, unstable. S minus, if this is, I don't know, 0, 1, okay? If this is the case, okay? this non-minimum phase phenomena occurs. Okay, and phenomenon occurs, an interesting phenomenon occurs if there is a zero in the right half plane. Look at here, you are commanding the output to reach at this level, okay, this steady state level. The response first goes just opposite direction. So bad, isn't it? Such an undesirable situation. It goes to opposite direction and then corrects itself and starts rising and reaching at the final desired level. Such an undesirable event, especially for aviation applications, because you are ordering the aircraft to go up, to pitch up, but it goes first down and then tries to pitch up. You may not recover this initial decrease in the pitching behavior. Okay. Well, why is it called non-minimum phase? I need to talk about the body diagrams. At the end of the term, we will get back to it if time allows. Okay. Now, if you could allow me for, we have a very short chapter, chapter 5 in the book. Okay, first of all, is there any question related to this? I think we need to do some quiz and assignments. I'll have a word with Ezgi Hanım. You got a lot of materials to revise, so you will be announced about the assignments and those quizzes, right? If there is no question or comments or whatever, I'll start with a new chapter, a short chapter, a short one. I'll finish it in I don't know, half an hour or so. So far, so good. Clear, my dear students, no? I have already uploaded chapter 5 here, and I uploaded both files to learn in the early morning. I'm sure you are aware of those two presentation files. Okay, we will be dealing with block or block diagrams. Okay, block diagrams. We can also represent systems with signal flow diagrams. Okay, and for reduction, we can use Mason's theorem. Okay, but this takes a little bit more time. That's why, as many lecturers do, I'll stick with representing systems with block diagrams. Okay, block diagrams. And I'll show you the simple block diagram algebra, some books call, so that you can do reduction or simplification in systems having multiple subsystems. Look at here. In block diagrams, let me zoom in a little bit. Okay. In block diagrams, we have some components. These arrows show the direction of the flow, direction of the signal flow, obviously, and the inputs, outputs. These are the signals. Okay, this is the system in a box, input, output, as you know. And we have also, we covered, you saw this, this is not the first time. This is called summing junction, okay? You can use it for comparison, subtraction or summation, but algebraic summation, okay? So the summing junction, okay, summing junction takes more than one inputs, okay, plus or minus inputs, but produces only one output, which is just algebraic summation of the inputs. And there is also so-called peak of point, or just node, okay, node. And it distributes the same signal to various locations, various points, okay? So you distribute R of S to here, here, and here. We have three basic connections of blocks, okay? Boxes. Let me make it even simpler, okay? Suppose that you have a system which consists of three subsystems, G1, G2, G3, okay? And each has a transfer function, G1 of S, G2 of S, G3 of S. If they are connected, cascade is a kind of connecting blocks in series. Well, some books I think use series connection, but connecting components, you can connect components in series, not the blocks. So it is called cascade connection, whatever. And each output, look at here, the output, the interim outputs, X2 is G1 times R of S. The output in here is, the input is X2 times G1 R, but since X2 is already defined as G1 R S, so G2 G1 R S, and this is the output in the same fashion. But in the end, you will see that the equivalent transfer function is just, you know, factoring these G1, G2, and G3, okay? So this is the cascade connection, so simple, okay? Unloading issue explained. Well, we are assuming that if you are connecting the blocks in cascade or in parallel, whatever, we assume that only we are transferring voltages, okay? Voltages, no current is transferred, no power dissipation occurs, no unloading is occurring, no loading, sorry. As if there is a isolating amplifier between the subsystems. So suppose that this is subsystem one, this is subsystem two. Cascading is not like this. Cascading these two subsystems, you can cascade, but with an amplifier, so that you are transferring only the voltage across the terminal of the first output, okay? Don't worry about it. It is just an assumption. Look at this parallel connection. This is the connection number two, okay? You have, again, three subsystems, and look at it. They are connected in parallel. The input side there is a node, there's a peak of point, the output is combined with a summing junction, okay? So the output will be, this is the, as you know, since this is a peak of point, there is an R of S here, there is an R of S here, R of S here, right? So this output will be R times G3. This output R times G2, R times G1. And according to this sign, you have to algebraically sum. So in R parentheses, G1 plus or minus G2 plus or minus G3, okay? So just add them up. And the equivalent transfer function will be, you create this output to input transfer function and you get G1 plus or minus G1 plus or minus G2 plus or minus G3. And finally, connection number three, feedback connection. Now look at this. You remember that so-called case study controlling the position of a satellite dish, right? Input transducer where you introducing your input. And this is your controller. This is your plant. Plant is your, here, your dish. The gearbox, the motor that rotates the position, changes the position of the dish. And you are measuring the output by means of an output transducer. And maybe you are filtering. There is another transfer function. And in the end, you are doing this feedback by comparison, comparing the output with the input. And this is a very typical feedback, or in more accurately, negative feedback. But this is general feedback, minus or plus. If it is minus, negative feedback. If it is plus, which is out of our scope, positive feedback. We are not dealing with positive feedback. Look at here. Now, tell me, can you say that G2 and G3 are connected in series? I mean, they are cascaded. Yes, because output of G2 is input of G3. They are directly cascaded. And H1 and H2 are cascaded, okay? How about now, can I say that here, a new transfer function can be defined as G1 of S times G2 of S, right? Because they are connected, cascaded. They are just cascaded. And here, at just H of S is H1 of S times H2 of S. So more, now for, what happened to G1? Suppose that we are not dealing with G1 for the, just for the time being, okay? So suppose that the simplified connection is in this one, plus, minus, okay? What we are looking for is, this is input, this is output. An equivalent transfer function, okay, which is output to input, the main output to the main input. I mean, can we transfer this to just one box where input is R, output is C, okay, and the transfer function is this, or you can name it closed loop transfer function. Now, this is output. Output is here, right? Can you say that output is suppose that the name of this signal is E of S, okay? E of S, and name let us name this signal B of S. Can you say that? Let me use blank. C of S is just E of S times G of S. Why not? The input signal times the transfer function gives the output, okay? And also, can you say that E of S is in fact the difference between R of S and B of S? No problem with that. One more thing, and we know that B of S is in fact, I never did, so many signal names, but for the sake of simplicity. What is B of S? B of S is, what is the input of this transfer function? There is a, how do you say, node here, pick off point. It takes C of S here and introduces to H of S. Because you are measuring the output, you are feeding back the output, yeah? So B of S, the feedback signal is C of S times H of S. In the end, I want to obtain this, okay? So you can, plug this last equation into the previous one and then this one to this one. So E of S becomes R of S minus C of S, H of S, okay? And finally, C of S becomes R of S minus C of S, H of S, times G of S, okay? There's one C of S here, another C of S is coming from the right-hand side, plus G of S, H of S, all right, times C of S, and what remained in the right-hand side is just R of S times G of S. And finally, the transfer function we are searching for is the output to input, which is what? G of S over 1 plus G of S, H of S. This is another must, let's say. Must for what? Almost to memorize. It's so easy. Don't worry about it. So you don't have to do all these steps, to obtain this. You have to know it by heart. How do we know that? How can we know that? If this is negative, this will be positive, obviously. In some books, especially in process control books, it says that the closed loop transfer function is C of S over R of S, which is the closed loop transfer function. This is feed forward transfer function, right? Transfer function. And this is loop transfer function or open loop. Let's say loop. Loop transfer function, okay? Feed forward or something, actually, not feed, feed forward can be said, but they say forward path transfer function. So forward path transfer function over 1 plus, assuming that this is negative, 1 plus loop transfer function. Okay, so So this is what you need to know, okay? Or you can obtain it if you are confused. But after writing for a couple of times, you will memorize, okay? So look at here. But now there was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bucks, and with a summing junction, it is only 1 bucks now. G of S. This is called reduction or simplification. Now we have 3 forms: 1, 2, 3, cascade, parallel, and feedback. Okay. So these are the familiar forms. Familiar. What is the meaning of familiar? Sort of known forms. Değil mi? Familiar. Ne diyorduk ona? Hani romantik bir karşılığı var, değil mi? Aşina olduğumuz, bildiğimiz formlar. Familiar forms. Now, some book call block so-called algebra. We need to move. Let me change color. We need to move blocks, okay, to get those familiar forms, okay, to get those known or familiar forms. Why is it so important? Why is it important? Because I want to convert some other source of connections to obtain those familiar forms, so that I can convert any complicated system to only one box system, so that I can establish a relationship between the input and output easily. Okay, suppose that first number one, and this is number two. Suppose that you have this connection, but you don't want to see it here. You don't want to see this block in here. You want to move this to the left of this summing junction. Well, it is a need, you know. Suppose you can move it. If you do this movement, you need to add the same block to the other input, or inputs even. Why do I have to memorize? Not really. No, I'm unfortunately not good at memorizing things. Look at here. How do you do that? Let me first write what is the C of S here. C of S here is R of S, right? R of S, I don't know, either minus or plus. This is plus. R of S, minus or plus X of S. Okay, so this is the signal, okay? Times G of S makes C of S, right? How about here? What is the signal in here? R times G. What is the signal in here? X times G. I mean X of S, G of S, whatever. C of S, what is the output here? R of S times G of S minus or plus XG. X of S times G of S. Aren't they the same? In G of S parentheses, okay. R of S minus or plus X of S. It makes sense, right? So if you want to move the block to the left of a summing junction, you need to add the same transfer function, the same block, to other inputs or inputs. There may be some more inputs, and you need to add to them as well, okay? All right. Suppose that you want to move the block to the right side of the summing junction. What you need to do? You need to add just inverse of this transfer function to other input or inputs. Okay, you can check it out. C of S is here, look at here. R of S times G of S minus or plus, plus or minus X of S. Whereas here, what is the value or the signal here? X times 1 over G, right? So here the signal will be R minus or plus, R of S, of course, you understand this. R plus or minus, minus or plus, X of S times 1 over G of S. Okay. We are here now. Times G of S gives us C of S. You see that this C of S and this C of S are the same if you do this. Okay. Good, so moving blocks to the left or to the right of the summing junction is this. Okay. How about if you want to move the block to the left or to the right of the pick-off point? This is even easier. If you do this movement, okay, if you move to the left of this peak point, you have to add the reciprocal or inverse of this transfer function to other outputs. It is the sort of the opposite here. And look at here, if you want to move this to the right of this peak of point, you have to add the same block to the other branches, okay? What is this? Didn't we cover this? No? Interesting. There's a repetition here. To the left, to the right, to the right. Okay. Are we doing okay? I like it to play with blocks. So I'm sure you will enjoy moving to blocks as well. Can you convert this to a one block system? So an equivalent G of S, okay, the input is R of S, the output is G of S. I know you can say that, I can give a name here. I can, spending some time. You can obtain the correct answer, but it'd be wise to if you use these algebra moving blocks. Okay, look at here. This is. Maybe for the sake of being an example, no need to use so many summing junction, okay? If there is nothing between if there is no block between the summing junctions, you can reduce them to only one summing junction, okay? Only one summing junction. You see, only one summing junction. And can you tell me, the connection type of this G2 and G3, they are just cascaded. So G of S is G2 times G3, okay? And how about H1, H2, and H3? Can you say that they are connected in parallel? Yes, because the input part is a kind of node, okay? And the outputs are combined. They get together in a summing junction, okay? Look at here. Shall I follow this or let me draw myself? Okay, so this is G1 of S, okay. And I can use only one summing junction, okay. And I can say that there is here only G, okay. And this is the output. Now suppose that H1, okay, H2, I'm dropping those S's, okay, function of S, H3, okay. Suppose that suppose that there is a node here, okay? So there is C of S here, C of S here, C of S here. And H1 with minus, H2 with plus, and H3 minus, okay? You can say that this is G1, this is G of S, okay? You can take only one H. Minus H1 plus H2 minus H3. But let us make this negative feedback. So H1 minus H2 plus H3, okay? Now, the classical feedback, there shouldn't be any block here. So move this to here, okay? Move this to, oops. Okay, move this block to here. How do we do that? Some of you guys will say, no need for that. I know, but suppose that we are still learning. Okay. G1, G2. Excuse me, G1, G of S, all right. But here, there will be just reciprocal of it, okay? H1 minus H2 plus H3 over G1, okay? Okay. Now, the transfer function is G of S, G1, which is G1 of S, G of S, over 1 plus this loop. G1, GS, G1, G, H1 minus H2 plus H3 over G1. Obviously, this will disappear. Okay, so this is the result. But in fact, as you remember, what was the easiest way? G of S was forward path transfer function divided by 1 plus loop transfer function. Forward path, G1, all right, G1, G2, G3, okay, divided by 1 plus loop transfer function. Loop is, the equivalent loop is this. The transfer function on this path, G1, G2, G3, G2, G3 times H1, H2 minus H2 and plus H3 of S. Okay, so the same. Of course, this G is G2 times G3. Okay, the same result. Now, let us have a look at this nice example. Okay. What is the closed loop transfer function of this? Shall I wait for you on, or let us be quick? Look at here. This is just S square, isn't it? Can you say that S square and 1 over S are connected in parallel? Yes, because input side is node, output is, you name it, summing junction. So we have here S square, let me do this. Okay, here we have S square plus 1 over S, which makes S cube plus 1 over S. So the equivalent block diagram will be S square plus 1 over S, okay. And what else we have? Now we got rid of this summing junction, and we have 1 over S here, 1 over S, there is a pickoff point here. Okay, plus, all right, there's a feedback here, okay. Unit feedback, in fact, here you can say that there is a 1, but if it is 1, it is not shown, okay, so it is 1 here. And what else we have here? 1 over S. 1 over S, and it goes where? It goes, it's a bit too long. All right. That's it. This is the equivalent diagram. Not that, so it's not finished yet. So, I think we'd better take this 1 over S, okay, take this 1 over S to the left of this summing junction. So if you do that, it'll come okay. If it was here as a S, it will go here and here the same. But if you do this way, it will go inversely. Okay. Okay, here it is. Look at here. If you take it to the left, you have to add the reciprocal to the other outputs. Okay. Now you can do or in fact, why shall we take it to this side? Why not? Yeah, let us do this. Some of you guys do this and let me do this, okay? There are many ways of solving this problem. Okay. So 1 over S. Okay. 1 over S. And this will be another 1 over S. 1 over S square. Now, This is one connection. And now this branch is where? Here, okay, yes. And there is another branch. You can put on top of it. Yes, something like this. Can you say that? Now look at three parallel branches, but in fact, only these two, one, two. These two are in parallel because this they are starting from the node, from the pick-off point, and ending at a summing junction. By the way, this is plus, minus, minus. So you can do this. Okay. S cube plus 1 over S. This is 1 over S. Okay. C of S. Right? And only 1. Yes. This is 1 over S square. Okay. Plus 1. Because they are in parallel. Plus 1. Here, 1 plus S square over S square. Now, remember the formula, okay? The transfer function, which is the ratio between the output, C of S, and input, all right? Forward path transfer function over 1 plus loop transfer function. Now, forward path transfer function is this. S cube plus 1 over S square. All right. Over 1 plus loop transfer function. S cube plus 1 over S times this. 1 plus S square. Make it S square plus 1. Over S square, S cube. Okay, you carry on and finish it, okay? It's done. Now, analysis and design of feedback systems. Now we are getting, give me another, I'll finish it. Definitely before 12:30, okay? Suppose that we have this transfer function, okay? And there's a feedback connection, isn't it? Consider the system shown in the figure below, which can model a control system such as the antenna azimuth position control system. Suppose that some subsystems are connected and this is obtained and we are doing this feedback, okay? What is the closed-loop transfer function? If this is G of S, okay, if this is G of S, and if this is H of S, which is unity, okay, the transfer function C of S to R of S is the, how do you say, the forward path transfer function, I mean the G of S over 1 plus H of S, G of S, just G of S. Right? So K over S square plus AS divided by 1 over K over 1 plus K over S square plus AS. You will see that you get this. S square, these will be simplified. S square plus AS plus K, okay? But let me let me tell you that if the feedback is unity, all you need to do is, okay, take this transfer function, k over, open it up, k over s squared plus as, and add this numerator, okay? K over s squared plus as plus k. So you don't have to do this. Anyway, so this is the transfer function. This is the closed loop transfer function, right? Okay, closed loop transfer function. Where are the poles of the closed loop transfer function? S12 is minus a over 2 plus and minus a square minus 4, 1 times k, 4k, okay? Let us change k, let us increase k from 0 to what is the value of k, which makes this depending on the value of gain, we can, or system can, the system can have real and complex poles, right? So a square minus 4k equals 0, k equals a square over k. For a between 0 and a square over 4, the square root of this is positive. The system produces overdamped responses, right? Overdamped responses. Very good analysis. Be very careful, okay? For or when k equals a square over 4, what happens? A square over 4, the roots S12 becomes only minus a over 2, real and repeated, right? Which means the system becomes critically damped. Very good. Critically damped. All right. And how about for if you keep increasing k and if it is more than a square over 4, the roots becomes complex conjugate, S12 becomes minus a over 2 plus n minus j, because the square root is negative, right? Plus n. 4k minus a square, okay, over 2. So the roots are complex conjugate, and the system or the response becomes underdamped. Interesting. Just playing with the gain, you get overdamped, critically damped, and underdamped responses. Can you have undamped response? No, you can. You cannot. No, you cannot. Why? Because we cannot make the real part zero. The real part, unfortunately, real part is not related to the value of gain k. Look at this simple example. For the system, find the peak time, percent overshoot, and settling time. What is the closed loop transfer function? Since this is unity, okay, simple. The numerator is the same, and denominator becomes s square multiplied plus 5s plus 25. Or if this is g of s, if this is h of s, okay, suppose that there's an h of s here, okay, you do this. G of s is g of s over 1 plus g of s h of s. Take h of s 1 because it is unity. And you will get this, okay? S squared plus 5s plus 25. Okay, tell me what is the value of omega n. Natural frequency is square root of 25, which is 5 radian per second. And 2 zeta omega n is 5. All right? Damping ratio is then 5 over 2 times omega n. 1 over 2 is 0.5. So it is an underdamped response. Okay, underdamped response. So we can talk about peak time. Otherwise, there is no peak. Only underdamped systems produces overshoot and undershoot. So peak time is estimated as pi over omega n square root 1 minus zeta square. We know omega n, 5. We know zeta, which is 0.5. So this is the peak time. And then percent overshoot is this simple, formula. And 16%, okay? So this is settling time, okay? You can obtain, everything wanted, okay? Now look at here, the last slide, okay? Determine the value of gain K for the feedback control system so that the system will respond with a 10% overshoot. It's a simple design problem, okay? So what is the closed loop transfer function? K over S square plus 5S plus now K. Okay, percent overshoot is 10. What is the damping ratio? Minus logarithm natural 0.1 divided by pi square plus ln natural logarithm. All right, do this. Percent overshoot is 10, okay. Zeta is 6, let's say zeta is 0.6, okay. Now, that means from the characteristic equation or denominator, you get 2 zeta omega n equals 5. We can determine omega n from here. Omega n equals 5 over 2 times zeta. And from here, omega n is 5 over 2 is 2.5 divided by zeta, 4.23 radian per second, okay. And K is, in fact, omega n square is K, isn't it? And K is omega n square, 17.88. Okay. So if you increase or if you make K more or less 18, okay, you get maximum 10%. 10% overshoot. And also you get, of course, peak time. You can compute. All right, 17.9. Although we are able to design for percent overshoot in this problem, we could not have selected settling time as a design criteria because interesting. How what is the real time? What is the settling time here? Settling time is here 4 over zeta omega n. right? Zeta, omega, and zeta. What is zero? Zeta, 0.6 times omega n is 4.23. Can we shorten the response in terms of settling time? No, because settling time, unfortunately, is not dependent on the value of k. That's what the book says. All right. More examples will come. Thank you so much for your patience. It is almost 12:30. Please ask your questions or send your comments about what I tried to explain. All the topics will be covered, included, okay, so far. But we need, I don't know if you have a, I think you have an exam, I mean, midterm exam week. But before that, you will get some assignments and quizzes so that you will be ready for the midterm. Okay, I can share some typical exam questions with Ezgi Hanım. So that you can get quite familiar with my problems. Those example problems are good enough to know my style, but you will get some more. Saturday, don't say that. Midterm exam. Okay, I'll have a word with Ezgi Hanım. We will make sure that you have at least one set of midterm one questions that were asked before. Okay. Also, maybe you can find some typical problems in my website in Yıldız, right? Let us check. There should be some control. Final. This is final exam. Quiz solutions. Come on, you don't wait for me. You know there are here examples. Look at here, dear all. Solutions of homework. There are problems here. You are responsible, up to this point. So you can select the questions. Don't go any further than chapter 5. So stability until the chapter for stability. Okay. So this is control systems design. Look at here, for example, example problems with solutions. Have a look at them. You will see lots of questions. Okay, and end of chapter questions of this Norman Nisi's book, which is, as I said, available in the internet. Free of charge. I don't know if it is legal or not, but you can find it easily. It is legal. I don't know. So lots of sources, but by all means, please ask problems, questions to me, to Ezgi, if you got stuck. All right. You'll be announced for this, for the time and everything. Bye bye then. Take care of yourselves. Bahar Hocam, you had a question. Well, we didn't know the values of poles, I just presented the general solution. I don't know if it is the answer to your question. We have calculated these relationships by assuming that the coefficients are all zero. The equation and found yes, but the other option is to plug in the poles in the equation to get yes, yes, we are doing this if you know the values of poles, you are right. Why didn't we try that? Because we I was presenting the general solution. But if you have an alternative solution, please share it with me. Okay. I would be really glad to have an alternative solution. Okay, bye-bye. Take care.